Well, my guest this week is Pulitzer Prize-winning author and journalist Hedrick Smith. He was in New Hampshire this week promoting his new book called Who Stole the American Dream, which looks at the direction of the country over the past four decades. Thanks so much for coming in.
My pleasure, Jim.
No, it's my pleasure to have you on this segment. Now, one thing that's been fascinating to me in the last four decades is it's very apparent that there have been a lot of things going on. Women and their equality and going to college and getting the workplace. We've seen gay rights, particularly in the last 5 or 6 years, has been dramatic. But one thing that has not been told is what's going on with the middle class. Really, until a series of books, and this is probably the biggest tome of that. So what is going on with the middle class in the last four decades?
The middle class has been losing out over the last three decades. We've seen the highest concentration of wealth practically in America's history. We had high concentration in the late 19th century. Citigroup said it's the highest concentration of wealth in any advanced country since 16th century Spain. So the people at the top have gotten a 600% pay raise since 1980, and the people in the middle have gotten zero. So you're seeing money going all the way to the top. The people who are in the middle were homeowners. They lost $6 trillion to the banks during the housing boom, not the bust, during the boom, because they were taking out bigger loans, second mortgages, refinancing. The banks were making money. The middle class was losing out. Wages have been stagnant. The
average. And you blame a lot of people in this book, in your research.
Right.
You look at politicians. You look at business. You look at the structures in which changing attitudes. What do you think? Talk a little bit more about what caused this situation.
Okay, power shift in Washington. Back in the 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, when the middle class was doing really well, shared prosperity, there were strong middle class movements, strong labor movement, women's movement, consumer movement, environmental movement, civil rights movement, citizen activism. There was a reaction to that by business leaders. There was a boss's revolt, if you want to call it that. And business moved in a big way. Business now outspends labor 60-1 in lobbying. That started in the late 70s.
Well, we'll get to more of that a little bit on this in the next segment, in the extended version. But thanks so much for coming in. Now, you can read more about politics at WMUR.com/political scoop. And that's also where you can find an extended version of this conversation. But that does it here for TV. Now back to you. Sorry I had to cut you off there a little bit. Go ahead and continue. Yes. Yeah.
Well, and the second thing that happened was we had a big change in the way business leaders thought. Back in the 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, Charlie Wilson, who ran General Motors, Reg Jones, who ran General Electric,
was good
Frank
Abraham,
well, they said they believed in stakeholder capitalism, and all the stakeholders who have a stake in the success of the corporation should benefit from it. So you pay your workers well, you deliver well to your stockholders, you take care of your suppliers, your bankers, your customers, the communities you live in. Today we have shareholder capitalism, and CEOs say, my job is to return maximum return to the shareholders, to the stock owners, to Wall Street. Well, that means pressure on wages. That means freezing wages. That means money going to the top and money not going to the middle. That's what we have today. We have a split economy and we have an unhealthy economy. Notice our growth, it's stuttering. We have low tax rates, relatively speaking. 35-40% is our maximum tax rate. Under Eisenhower, 92%. Under Kennedy, 77%. Growth rate, 3 or 4%. No connection between maximum tax rate and growth. Now we think it's taxes. No, it's not. It's consumer demand. Workers, middle class Americans, here in New Hampshire and all across the country, are not making enough money. And if they don't have money to spend, they don't spend, it doesn't drive the economy.
We have
an inequality that's not only unfair, it's not smart economics.
One reason I really enjoyed your book was it wasn't just dry numbers and making you feel sad, but it's also about narratives. And you go to Circleville, Ohio. This small town of about 12,000, and you describe them in the 1970s, and two residents of the Circleville, Ohio in the 1970s were my parents. My dad was working at the Purina plant for a long time. What happened to Circleville? What happened with that story?
Wait, it's Pam and Mike, we'll call them, and that's what their names are. Yeah. Pam and Mike, they're real people in Circleville. They come out of high school, Chillicothe High School in the town next door. They get hired at the RCA Television 2 plant, just opened. They both start down at the bottom, and they work their way up. And they work there until 2004. And they're, by the time they leave the plant, when the plant shuts down, Pam is making $50,000, $60,000 a year, and Mike's doing about the same. They're both doing well. Mike has a hell of a time finding another job. Pam finds a job reasonably quickly, but then that plant shuts down and lets her go too. They bounce around. Mike is now working as a night watchman at a high school And he's making $13,000 a year. Now, this is a guy who was making $60,000 a year just 7 or 8 years ago. I mean, he's in desperate straits. If his wife didn't have a public sector job, he'd be in poverty, okay? Pam Scholl has bounced around. She was unemployed for a year and a half. She finally got taken as a census taker at one point. She said, it was amazing to talk to her, to listen to her. It's really sad. Those of us who have not been long-term unemployed do not know the psychological impact of that. She was said, when I got to be a census taker, she said, I suddenly felt useful again. I had gone 18 months without working. I had never experienced that in my life. I'm a hard worker. I'm committed to work. And suddenly I couldn't get a job, and I tried everywhere, and I felt like I was on the ash heap. And I get this thing, and then she loses the census taker job. It's only for a month. Right. And then she goes unemployed for a while. She's now working. She got a job in the sheriff's department, and she's now making about half the pay that she made before. That's a fairly typical story. People get rehired, but they wind up by going from a good industrial job to working for Walmart at $8 an hour or someplace else like Walmart at $8 an hour. It's a tremendous come down in the living standards of these people. And it's not surprising. They can't make their mortgage payments. They can't send their kids to college. They're not sure about the security of their retirement. It's a human story, and I'm so glad you brought that up, Jim, because this book is not just about the numbers. And America's economy is not just about numbers. It's about real people going through real agony. What we had before, when we had the American dream in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, was not only good wages, steady jobs, people had economic security. Yes, we had booms and busts in the economy. People got laid off when we had a downturn, but the GM workers got hired back by GM when the economy turned up. That's not what happens now. Those jobs disappear. They don't come back. People have to go somewhere else.
And look, you live in Washington. You're the former New York Times Washington bureau chief. You understand the city. A few months ago, we had Mark Leibovich in your chair and talking about his new book, This Town. And one thing that really struck me about that, it's really a story about class. Forget all the political personalities. It's that Washington is a really rich place now. 7 of the 10 richest counties in the country are in D.C. and in the surrounding areas. Do you see that as a major factor as to why some of these issues are not getting addressed? These people in Washington just aren't living this reality.
Absolutely. It isn't just Washington. It's all over the country. People who are talking about these issues are people like you and me. Look at our skin color, yep. Look at our incomes, look at our job security. How the heck can we understand how other people live? When I was going
at least
through,
we're talking about it.
We're talking
about
it.
A lot of people are not talking about it.
Okay, but in the recession, during that period, 2009, 2010, I would go out on Friday and Saturday night in Bethesda, which is just outside of Washington, and the restaurants are jammed, and people are ordering a second bottle of wine and a dessert and a very fancy meal, and I'm thinking, where am I? What's going on? I'm reading unemployment is 10%. The Pew Charitable Trust did a poll on America, and they asked Americans to describe their experience economically. And there was one group, basically people making more than $75,000 a year and older people, and others below that and younger people. And they had, it was two Americas. It was very interesting. They put the headline on their poll, one recession, two Americas. And that's really this. We are two Americas now. We are two countries. We don't understand each other. We're divided by power, we're divided by economics, and now we're divided by ideology. And we're having a very hard time grappling with this because one side doesn't understand the other side, and the side that isn't understood doesn't have the political power or the muscle or the economic clout to speak up for itself.
Hedrick Smith, thanks so much. Thanks so much for coming in. And we've learned John Edwards is right. There are two Americas.
Actually, Edwards or not, we are two Americas, yeah. And it's dangerous. Let me just finish. Mm-hmm. I appreciate your thank you. But let me just. Lincoln warned us, a house divided cannot stand. Arnold Toynbee, the great British philosopher, said, societies can die from within when there's schisms in the body politic and schisms in the soul of society. I think we're right there. We've either got to pull out of this or we're not in good shape.
Thanks so much for coming in.
Thanks.
And thank you for watching WMUR.com.